Well, first I need to establish that you can hear me okay, because obviously I speak English properly. And so you can hear me at the back okay? Everything, you can hear me good? Why do people sit at the back like that? Because they're Anglican now. So apparently I'm the first speaker. Someone said, you should feel very proud. There's another way of interpreting that. You had no one else to get. I mean, that's the Coren. He's local. He'll do it, won't he? And so it's a real pleasure to be here. And now I'm unemployed. You know, now Sun News is gone, the way of all flesh. Now I have all this time to come and speak to beautiful churches. But actually, when I did the TV show on Sun News, although it aired at 7 p.m., oh dear, we recorded it earlier, so I could always do evening things. But yeah, I'm not a member of the unemployed. Not really. I do other things too. But in case anyone is wondering, where is Sun News? That February the 13th, Friday the 13th of February, it went under. And it was very interesting because I was at home and I was watching TV and I was on the laptop, as all teenagers are. And I was on Facebook and a message came across. And I've got 5,000 friends on Facebook. Strange thing is, I'm so very lonely. But apparently I have 5,000 friends. And one of them wrote, I'm sorry to hear about Sun News. And I said, oh no, that's just a rumor. He said, oh, because my mum said she just heard it on the CBC. And I thought, oh. Because the CBC is never wrong. You know, men used to run away to sea. Now they run away to the CBC. And so I started to Google, and indeed, it seemed that Sun News was to be closed. They just hadn't told us about it. And then I emailed people in authority, and they said, we can't tell you at this stage. I took that as a yes, you're out of work. And at 5 o'clock that morning, I wasn't awake, I was in bed, but 5 o'clock that morning, apparently, Sun News suddenly went black, and this sign came up saying no more, or words to that effect. And then following morning, I do a radio panel a couple of times a week on CFRB, and I had a panel that morning, so I went in, and you can imagine the topic of conversation. And I went to the TV station. It was very strange because there's everybody. I mean, everyone who works there. There are about 200 people, I think. And they're all there in clothes you've never seen them in before. And they're all sort of, without anyone looking, although you can see, taking things, you know. I was waiting for someone to walk out with a camera, but that never happened. So that was the end of Sun News. And Lord, thank you for a very generous severance package in my contract. That's all I can say. Thank you very much. Because I have 4 children to look after. So that was the end of Sun News. I'll be absolutely honest with you, good and bad. I was never quite as conservative as the station. I think I was a bit off-brand, really, for it. So it was just one of those things. I did that for 4 years. Before that, I was 13 years at what was CTS. It's now Yes TV. And I've gone back there to do some interviews for them. You'll be seeing a few of those if you do watch the channel. And what else do? I write columns and magazine articles, and I write books, and I speak, and radio, and all sorts of things. I came to Canada in 1987. I'm from London, England, suburb of London, England. And I came to Canada in 1987, and the reason, there's nothing sinister. And the police were not looking for me. Maybe they are now, but they weren't then. But in 1986, I was invited over. 1986, I was invited over to the University of Toronto to give a lecture at a conference on G.K. Chesterton. You've all read G.K. Chesterton, haven't you? This is where people look down. Oh, don't pick me. It doesn't matter if you're... He was a wonderful writer. He died in 1936. So 86 was the 50th anniversary of his death. And his papers, believe it or not, were in Saskatoon. Why? I don't know. But they were stored out in Saskatoon. So they had a big conference at U of T, at St. Michael's College. And I was writing a book on Chesterton, not a very good book. But they invited me over to be one of the speakers. There must have been 30 speakers there from Britain, France, Japan, Argentina, I mean, all over the world. And I was about 100 years younger than anybody else speaking there. I was in my mid-20s then, they were sort of more elderly. A lot of tweed, I remember, a lot of tweed and bow ties and things. And I gave a lecture, and I still remember the title of it, and good Lord, it was boring. It was G.K. Chesterton, Hilaire Belloc, the Marconi scandal, and Edwardian anti-Semitism. I know. Forgive me. And that's what I'm going to give you tonight. No. So, and it was an academic paper, so I read it out, you know, word for word for word. And that was the end of the conference, and it was fairly interesting. And there was a big party at the end. If you've ever been to an academic conference, the best bit is the cocktail party at the end. So the party, and everyone was drinking their sherry, and I was standing there. And a very beautiful young woman, big brown eyes, olive skin, just lovely. She came up to me, and I'm pretty sure she was drunk. Because she came up to me, and this is absolutely true, she said, "You're amazing." And thinking this may never happen again, I married her. And it hasn't happened again. And you know what? The more I think about it, after 27 years of marriage, I don't think she's ever said it again. But tough, because we have 4 children and she's a Roman Catholic. So she can't get away from me. That's why I'm in Canada. I married a Canadian. If you're it's obvious, isn't it? If you're looking for residency, marry a Canadian. So that's how I came here. My first job was at the CBC, and then I was at TVO, and I've done all sorts. I've been fired by everybody over the years. So, and I became a, I suppose the nomenclature is always rather clumsy, but I became a Christian, if you like, in 1985. I came into the Catholic Church in 1985. We have 4 children, by the way. Our oldest, Daniel, is 26 years old. He's doing his PhD in logic. Yep, I'll be keeping him for a long time. He's doing his PhD in logic in the US. Then we have Lucy, she's 24, she lives in Paris. And you should hear her talk about Parisians. Very interesting. Entente cordiale. And then we have Oliver, who's 21, he's at Queen's. And then we have Lizzie, who's at home, and she is 17. She went to one period of school today. She just had a week off. And still, she misses most of school. I don't quite get it myself. "It's okay, Dad," she said. And if she said it's okay, it must be okay. Because she's 17. And she's a lovely girl. She gets into a little bit of, not trouble, but she takes after her mom, you see. So she keeps, we were called into the school once because apparently a teacher was very upset. A very young teacher, first year of teaching, thus knew everything. And she was teaching the children, I think it was an English class. It may have been world religion, I'm not sure. But she said to them, "Now, there are many religions in the world, and they're all the same, really, apart from Christianity, which is very bad." And she said, "Now, I am an atheist." Believe me, she couldn't define it. If Bertrand Russell couldn't defend his atheism, neither could this teacher. But I'm an atheist. "Is anybody here an atheist?" You know, and the kids are sitting there, whatever, put their hands up. And Lizzie doesn't put her hand up, and the teacher said, "Liz, it is Liz, isn't it? Yeah. You didn't put your hand, are you not an atheist?" "No, I'm not an atheist." "What are you?" Hoping she was a new age traveler, Buddhist, seeking enlightenment. And Liz said, "Well, I'm a Christian." She's not the greatest Christian on earth, I have to tell you. "I'm a Christian." And the teacher, you could, "Whoa. Oh, Christian, are you? And enlighten the class, Liz, why are you a Christian?" And Lizzie said, "Well, not wanting to be there. Mum's a Christian, Dad's a Christian, so I'm a Christian." And the teacher said, "Well, that's no reason to be anything. I mean, what about if Mum was a moron and Dad was a moron, what would you be then?" And Lizzie said, "Well, then I'd be an atheist." All right, it didn't happen. Okay, it didn't happen, but it made you laugh. So, I mean, that's all that. Although that is pretty much the level of atheist discord. There was someone, at least one person here, who was at the debate last week between John Lennox and Professor DiCarlo. Anyone else there, the debate? There were 1,000 people there. There were 1,000 people at Knox Church in Toronto. And I had the great privilege of interviewing Professor Lennox in the morning for TV, and then we had lunch together. And he teaches at Oxford, and his opponent teaches in Oshawa. I say nothing. I'm not going to construe anything from that juxtaposition. But, Lennox was so gracious and brilliant and scholarly and compelling, and the atheist, as is often the case, in the end, when pushed, just became flippant and aggressive and rude, actually. And that's generally been the case, with exception maybe of Christopher Hitchens, who I worked with Chris Hitchens years ago. He was actually a wonderful man in many ways. But generally, there can be a great deal of aggression and even and rudeness. And John Lennox, by the way, heard the final lecture of C.S. Lewis at Cambridge in 1962. And Lewis is, I suppose, my hero. If anyone is a hero, it will be Lewis. And we're very lucky. We know Walter Hooper. Walter was Lewis's last secretary, and Walter is a friend of ours. We see him every year in Oxford. But I said to Professor Lennox, what was it like, the lecture? And he said, well, it was amazing. He said, because he started the lecture as he walked into the room. So he walks into the room, and he's taking his coat and his scarf and his hat off, and he's already started. And he ended leaving the room, you know, getting dressed and leaving the room. So, I mean, it was quite incredible. And he was just a marvelous man. Christian for a reason. It's one of those cop-out titles, because I can say absolutely anything to you. It really doesn't matter. So what I'll do is I'll chat for a while, and then we'll have Q&A. And Q&A is really a euphemism. It really means person here being lazy, because in all seriousness, I think it's wonderful to respond. I don't like the word dialogue or, you know, sharing or that sort of, I don't know what it means. But just, you know, there's a lot of things that you may want to ask. So rather than me to speak at you for too long, I will speak for a while and then you ask me whatever you want about anything. Religion, TV, soccer, all things I'm an expert on, and I'll endeavor to answer. I wasn't raised a Christian. I was raised in a very secular home. My parents, especially my father, had a disdain for organized religion, all organized religion, actually. He was not a fan. And so it was a very typically English home in many ways. It was very secular. And I first became interested in Christianity when I was at high school. And we learned about the Reformation, which I'd never heard of until I was about 13 or 14. And it fascinated me. And I was interested, and I thought about Christianity. I was at about 14 now. No, I'll move on. And then when I was about 17, I thought about it again. No, I'll move on. I went to university, and I thought about it a lot. But I didn't go through with it. And then in 1984, I went to see a priest at a church in central London where I was living. And the following year, I was baptized, confirmed on the same evening. And I've always compared it to standing on a beach and a wave, a dribble of water goes over your ankles and you just sort of kick the water free. And then another wave comes in and goes over your knees and you just brush yourself down. And then another wave comes in and it goes over your head. And at this point, you either swim or you drown. And for me, it was very much like that. People often ask me about my conversion, especially in more evangelical settings. And they're looking for something which is very dramatic. You know, I want the bullets flying over my head, and I'm like, no. It was more banal than anything. I'd always wanted to live in the center of London. I grew up in a suburb. I'd always wanted to live in the very center of London, have books published, and go to fashionable literary parties. I had it. I had this very little apartment in Bloomsbury in the center of London. It was tiny. I had two books published by the time I was 24. They were terrible books, but they were published by a real publisher. And I went to literary parties. You know, Salman Rushdie once got me a date. I know, my claim to fame, he once got me a date. Look what happened to him. And I don't think they were related. And I remember just thinking to myself, I thought, well, is this really it? You know, you wanted all of this. I mean, you intensely wanted all this. And now you have it. And are you happy? Well, you're not unhappy, but is this really fulfillment? Are you complete? There's a wonderful phrase in contemporary Hebrew. It's a very mutable language because it evolves as it works with Arabic around it and with English and with Russian, many Russian immigrants and so on. But mashlom cha, which is how you're doing, or mashlom ich, I think, is the feminine of it. But it really means, are you complete? So, you know, how are you doing? How are you? How are you? but it actually means, are you complete, or is your journey complete? And that notion of completion, I think, is very important. People can be intensely happy without Christianity. If you think that people are unhappy without God or without Christ, no, many people are very happy. They can go to their death, tragically being happy. But it's been complete, isn't it? And I did not feel complete in any way. But it wasn't dramatic. It was a hole, a vacuum, a God-shaped vacuum, I suppose. And I came into the Roman Catholic Church, and over the years I've sort of wandered around in Christendom. Still am doing a bit of wandering. I think I've found my home. There are so many compelling arguments for Christianity, and there are so many arguments against it, and I've heard them all. The reason I wrote that book, Heresy, 10 Lies About Christianity, is I do a lot of speaking all over North America, and there's always someone who will say, I've got an argument against Christianity, and I bet you've not heard it before. And I say, how much money do you want to bet? I've heard them all. I've heard every one. I've heard every argument against Christianity. I'm not saying they're all absurd. Some of them are quite strong. But there's no such thing as the new atheism. Now, they coined this phrase, new atheism. Well, I mean, there was new wave music. That was great. That was when I was 18 or 19. That was brilliant, you know. But new atheism, it's like the new age. There's nothing new about dressing up as what you think is a Wicca or a Druid and running around Stonehenge. I mean, that's really old. It didn't even happen anyway. So the new atheists, it's the old arguments. What is different is that someone like Bertrand Russell or George Bernard Shaw just delivered them with far more grace and brilliance than Sam Harris or Richard Dawkins. And it's interesting with Richard Dawkins. I think he's really shown himself. He's increasingly desperate to be noticed. So he keeps becoming more and more radical and being more provocative and more silly. And he just marginalizes himself. Actually, Grayling is quite similar in that way. But I've heard all of these arguments, and we can go through some of them, but, you know, they really don't stand up to scrutiny. There are those that are meant to be based on history. Well, look, the crimes committed by Christians. Well, so what? So what? Crimes have been committed by liberals. Does that mean liberalism is not to be considered? They're being committed by conservatives, by socialists, by Canadians. Crimes are committed by people. It doesn't make any... It shows the brokenness of human nature, not the brokenness of Christianity. What is different about Christianity is that every Christian who has committed a crime, who has broken a moral law, has done so not because of, but in spite of the words of Jesus Christ. I was chatting about this briefly to someone outside. I'm not a theologian, but the problem with Islam and this relativist idea that all religions are the same, it's extremism that's the problem. Well, I'm sorry, but if you can find me where Jesus calls for violence, we can talk about it. But he doesn't. He calls his followers to carry a sword on the street in case they're mugged. He turns over tables where they're selling bruised goods, thus disgracing the temple and God. But otherwise, he's a man of absolute peace. Well, Muhammad was a war leader. I'm not playing this simplistic game that Islam is bad. Islam contains much of this beautiful and poetic, and the Quran has some most wonderful verses in it. But it also, there are also aspects of Quranic teaching and the life of Muhammad that involve war and violence. Religions aren't the same, but Jesus does not call for violence, but the very opposite. So if anyone commits a crime, violence, persecution, torture, and certainly Christians have, it's not been as bad as people claim, but there have been lots of problems. But it's not because they're too Christian, but because they're too little Christian. And I wrote this recently. So I'm in a strange position the past year or so. I've been accused of being a terrible liberal. I never thought that would happen to me. I've been accused of being too liberal. And I said, I've never criticized Christians for being insufficiently liberal. I've criticized Christians for being insufficiently Christian. But Christianity, however we scrutinize, can defend itself rather well. I mean, the final analysis, if you want absolute proof, you're not going to have that. And you can't have that by its very nature, because if we are allowed the freedom to choose, if we're allowed free will, which is a prerequisite for any love relationship, any man who says, I love my wife so much, I lock her in her room every night, that's not love. It's not love. I love my wife so much that I make every decision for her. You know, I don't. I have the bank card and I have all the money and I have the car keys because I really love her. No, you're an abuser. Well, God does give us free will. This is not a cop-out, but we have to have freedom. Otherwise, it's not a love relationship. And God has given us scriptures and commandments and kings and queens and prophets and finally his son to die in agony. I mean, we reach for God, but really it's God reaching for us, trying to get us back. And he gives us his son to die in agony. And there is abundant proof and evidence if we make an effort. And I think within us, within all of us, is the need to make that effort. But if God was unavoidable, if the truth of Christ was unavoidable out of pure self-interest or even greed, pride, we would all be Christian and thus not really be Christian. We have to have the freedom to choose. We have to have that. And it can be the very last moment of life. And we're always forgiven forever and ever. We're in the forgiving business. That wasn't my line. It was a man I knew. He was the chaplain at Manchester United. John, years ago, and I did something I shouldn't have. It wasn't on purpose, but I did something that it caused him a problem. And I said, John, I'm really sorry. Do you forgive me? And he said, Mike, I'm in the forgiving business. We're in the forgiving business. But I think there is abundant proof and evidence, if we just seek for it, of God. And the arguments, that are thrown are not new and they're not convincing. You know, why do bad things happen to good people? I'd say two-thirds of all lectures I've given, someone will say, if there is a loving God, why do bad things happen to good people? Oh, well, that's it, then there's my faith gone. I've never heard that one before. Oh, no. So, okay, you're right, I'm an atheist. Okay, end of lecture. And they always deliver it as though it's original. You know, okay, here's what... The other one is Galileo. They always mention Galileo. I always say, spell it. They never... I mean, the thing about Galileo, he was a Christian. Galileo was a devout Christian. You can criticize some elements within the Roman Catholic Church, but it wasn't about the Christian faith. But, you know, bad things happen to good people as though you've never thought about this. I mean, it's the first thing I said we do consider. And not only that, why do good things happen to bad people? Well, that's just as annoying in a way. Yeah. The guy down the road who is the most colossal swine you've ever met, he's just won the lottery. Thank you, God. Thank you so much. You know, I play it every week, and he's won it. Yeah, bad things happen to good people. Terrible things. Genocide, Holocaust, children dying of cancer, churches collapsing and killing everyone inside. That's a problem for the materialist. That's a problem for the atheist, not for the follower of Christ. If you believe that at death you are food for worms, you are dust, you are nothing, then that's a real conundrum for you. If you believe that this is only the land of shadows, and real life hasn't begun yet, if you believe that this 70, 80, 90, 100 years on earth is just a preparation, if you believe that your end is your beginning, then this is less of a challenge. Of course it will give you enormous pain. But does it really destroy your faith? Well, that's just a cop-out, is it? Is it? I mean, it could well be that Christianity is just a crutch that we lean on. But equally so, atheism could be. The Christian believes there is judgment. The atheist says, I'm not to be judged. Which is easier? I'd argue it's much easier to think you're never going to be judged. Do whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it. There are no consequences. Oh, bad things happen to good people. They do. God doesn't guarantee a good life. He guarantees a perfect eternity. These people who indulge in prosperity preaching, God forgive them, because I can't. And they've got it so wrong. If you believe, you will be cured. Some of the finest Christians I've ever met will never leave their wheelchair. You may not be cured. You may never survive. And it's interesting, when these cures take place in these large churches in the United States and someone is cured, why is it they never grow another limb? It's never someone with one leg. the leg's grown back. It's always their bad back. Suddenly it's okay. I mean, that's easy. We can all do that. I believe God created the world. I believe in intelligent design. I don't think it was 6 days. I don't think the world is 6,000 years old. I think evolution tells us how it all happened and that there is no contradiction between church and science. And indeed, the church has been the handmaiden of science down the centuries. It's been, if you want people who really oppose scientific breakthroughs and discovery, it will be the great atheists of the 20th century. Stalin, he would actually fire people or kill people in the Soviet Academy of Sciences who disagreed. They may be right scientifically, but they disagree with Soviet policy. Hitler, well, we know what Hitler did. It's been the atheists who've opposed scientific progress, not Christians. And by the way, just to refer back to Galileo, his torture was terrible. He wasn't allowed to leave his enormous mansion for 2 weeks. I don't know how he coped, but he did apparently. I mean, you know, he had servants, the food was brought in, it was wonderful, it was the most incredible life ever, but that was the torture, that was enough for him. There are lots of intellectual arguments for the truth of Christianity. The more we learn, the less we should doubt. You have allegedly intelligent people saying, we don't even know if Jesus existed. Oh, come on. Jesus, the Son of God, well, that's a claim. But Jesus existed? There are so many non-Christian writers who refer to him. Pliny the Younger and Josephus, who was a Jewish general who betrayed his people and became a Roman. Now, some of his writings were probably changed to make them seem more Christian. But even without the editing, he quite clearly refers to Jesus. We know there was Jesus. And whether you believe he was the Son of God is something different, but we know there was Jesus. The more we learn about biblical archaeology, the more we realize these things actually were true. They were there. There are some areas that haven't been proven. But generally speaking, the more we find out, the more the Christian story seems to be true, which directly contradicts the thinking of the rationalists of the 19th century, because they believed, with great authority and confidence, that the more we discovered, the less we would believe. It's not true. The opposite is the case, in fact. The more we discover, the more reason there is to believe. As for the claim of Jesus, and once again, you can never say with absolute proof and evidence that it's true. That will be a contradiction. You couldn't. God does not want that. But if you think about the psychology and the sociology, you know, people die for the wrong reasons. People die for Adolf Hitler. So you can't use that one. They died for him. Well, so what? But those people died believing that Hitler was correct. Why did they die? Why did those people in that room who saw him, why did all but one, I suppose, die an agonizing death? Because of what they were told? Because of what they read? Or because of who they knew and what they saw? They were there with him. And there's this strange theory, this everyone who lived in the first century was an idiot theory. Have you ever heard this? It was an image, you know, it was a hologram. This is said by 21st century people who never see death, who are terrified of mortality. These are, what have you got here? You've got a former terrorist leader, you've got a dock worker, a tax collector, who were the worst of the worst because they did the Romans' job for them, the occupiers' job. Former prostitute. I mean, these are rough street people. They see death every day. And they see the man they knew, who they slept next to and held and spoke with and loved. They see him dead on a cross. They saw death a lot. He's dead. They see him again alive. The wounds are in front of them. And they were all just, it could be. I mean, look, yeah, it's probably him. We'll go and die, shall we? I mean, you know, there are some things you just simply cannot believe. And one of them is that they were fooled and conned and lied to. They died only because they saw him after the resurrection. When the crucifixion took place, they were in despair. They didn't know what to do. He was gone. They were in panic. It was, of course, the women who were the toughest and bravest of them. The men just took all the credit later. But they saw him. That's why they were willing to die. There's no absolute proof. I can tell you stories and show you documents, but in the end, it has to be that leap of faith, if you like, that commitment to relationship, which is what it is. It is a relationship. It's the Son of God holding out his hand and saying, oh, I want so much for you to take it, but it has to be you who takes my hand. I can't make you. And he lets us go. And he lets us go wrong sometimes. He doesn't send us to hell. God doesn't send us to hell. We send ourselves to hell. Often a hell we deny. God made us for two purposes, to love him and be loved by him. And he wants us back with him. But if we keep rejecting him time and time again, if we want eternity away and apart from God, that will be granted to us. That's in our hands. But he must give us the freedom to... I remember our eldest son, Daniel, who's 26 now, the one who is studying logic, so he can have a wonderful career in teaching logic, in fact, is what he will do to people who will then learn how to teach logic. It's a wonderful world. Logical. When he first took the TTC to school, we live in Hyde Park, and he went to De La Salle College downtown. And we would drive him, usually my wife actually would drive him, but he reached an age when he had to go on his own. But he was still quite young. But off he went to school. Now, it's only Toronto, it's only the TTC. I mean, it's not the South Bronx or anything. But even so, you know. And I was waiting for him at about 3:30. Now, the school didn't even finish at about 3:45, so he's not going to be back till 5 o'clock. But at 3:30, I'm sitting close to the door, trying to look nonchalant and indifferent. And about 5 o'clock, he walks in, and he says hello to me in teenage. He says, and goes upstairs to do whatever teenagers do. I don't even want to think about it. And the thing was, I was so glad he was home. I was so relieved that he was home, but I had to let him go. You're a big boy. But I was so happy when he came home. Will you imagine that multiplied and magnified beyond our comprehension? God creates us. He has to let us go, but he wants us back. And the rejoicing when we do, and the sorrow when we don't. There are many ways. It's not a group of sayings you have to recite. It doesn't fit in a particular place. It's just that commitment to God, to Christ. As I get older, I'm increasingly convinced that there are many ways to him. I didn't always think that. I mean, I've written things a few years ago I would never write today. But I suppose we grow, we evolve, we mature. I hope that's the direction I'm going into. Or maybe it's just increasing senility, I don't know. My dad, I mentioned I grew up in a secular home. My parents were good people. It was a very ordinary family. The extraordinary within the ordinary, you know. Upper working class home. My dad was a cab driver, you know those black cabs in London, England. Hard-working man. He was an intelligent man, but he left school when he was... The war was on. He was in the RAF when he was 17. End of the war, 1944. But he was in Bomber Command when he was 17 years old, and I can only imagine what he saw. He didn't speak about it very much. But so he came from an immigrant family as well, so limited formal education. He could have gone to any university in the world, but he was RAF and left the RAF, and he eventually drove a cab. And he worked very hard. He worked 7 days a week. And he worked hard for us. Religion he did not like. He was very fair, though. It didn't matter. Christian, Jewish, contempt for both. Islam barely existed in those days in Britain. I'm sure he would have been very, very interesting about Islam. But he loved all people pretty well. He was nice to all people, but do not tell me about religion. Now, I came into the Catholic Church in 1985, and he said to me, if it makes you happy, just don't tell me about it. So I didn't. Well, I did a bit, you know. And then I met my wife in 86, and we got married in 87. And he wrote a letter to my wife when we got married. This was pre-email and you know, was the internet around in 87? Beginning, I suppose. But anyway, my parents would never have used it. They probably thought the devil was in it or something. Not that they really believed in it. And he wrote my wife a letter, and it said, "Dear Bernie," Bernadette is her name, "Dear Bernie, I love you, and I love Michael, and everything I have is yours." He never even owned a new car. He didn't have much. But if I saw Michael married in a Catholic church, I'd be physically sick. And I got very upset. And my wife said, "Mike, you've got to understand." She's annoyingly Christian, you know. "You've got to understand where he's coming from." And I said, "Boom." Anyway, it was hurtful. It was hurtful. My mom was there, my best man, my oldest friend, but my dad wasn't there. And he didn't come to Canada. He wouldn't come to visit us in Canada. And I knew why, because he said, "Well, I can't take the time off work." But he was semi-retired. He wouldn't come over. I knew what it was. He was frightened of what he thought was the religiosity of our home. He probably thought that we were going to jump on him and forcibly baptize him, which we were, actually. So he never came. My mum came over to visit us every couple of years. We went back. But my dad never came to Canada. And it hurt me. He didn't see his grandchildren growing up. Then I got a phone call one day from my mum. And I could tell she was emotional, which she wasn't very often. I said, "Mum, what is it?" And she said, "Mike, dad's had a very bad stroke. And they don't think he's going to pull through." I flew over that night. Air Canada, who couldn't have been nicer to me. And night flight that morning, you know, I didn't sleep. Terrible feeling you have. Got the underground subway to my parents' house in the suburb. Knock on the door, there's my mum. We hug. We get into my dad's used car, drive to the hospital, walk into the ward, and there's my dad. My dad was a tough, big, tough man. And it was as though he'd become a baby again. He was sitting up in bed, and there was the IV in his arm, and there was some blood and stitching from where he'd fallen on the back of his head, and there was saliva, and there was some movement, but no sort of consciousness, and really. And they said, "Look, he may understand what you're saying. Assume he can." So we try to be normal. We chat to each other. We tell jokes. We talk about the weather. There isn't any weather in Britain, and it was very awkward. And then the doors of the ward open, and my sister came in, and my sister is looking at the ground, doesn't know what to do, like us. And then my brother-in-law looking at the ground, doesn't know what to do. And then my niece, Tessa, walks in, doesn't know. So we have me, my mum, my sister, my brother-in-law, my niece, five people, not knowing what to do. And then another person comes in, and she apparently does know what to do. This is my other niece, and her name is Katie. And how old was she then? 7. And she jumps, bounds like Tigger, you know, in Walt Disney, into the room. And she jumps on the bed in a British hospital. "You don't do this. No, don't do this." And then she gets under the blankets of the bed in the British hospital. And she puts her arms around her grandpa. And she falls asleep. Because that's what she does whenever she sees grandpa. So I should explain to you that Katie is what is known as, I always get the terminology wrong, handicapped, disabled. She's profoundly autistic. Profoundly. So not someone in a movie who can solve crossword puzzles and win at casinos. I mean she will never live alone. Almost impossible to understand what she says. She's irresponsibly tactile, very trusting, very credulous. Noises which upset some people. And she puts her arms around her grandpa and she falls asleep. Because she doesn't judge, you see. We may love him, but we are judging. We're judging the situation and but she has not judged. For the first time in 2 days, my father shows emotion. He cries. The tears bisect his cheeks. And then he moves his head a bit. He had moved before this. But his eyes seem to take on a life that they didn't have. There was nothing there. And he seems to be staring at me, and I think it's some sort of spasm, a muscle spasm, and I think to myself, no, he's looking at me. And then his lips begin to tremble, and with an effort that seems superhuman, he's trying to make a word, and he says the word, and it's my name, Michael. He says it again and again, and we press the panic button, and the doctor, who I think was 12 years old, he runs in. He's a very nice guy, and he said, this is exactly what he said. Oh, this is a miracle, he said. He didn't mean that. He meant it wasn't in his textbook. And my father had a 90% recovery. That little girl, despised by many, gave the gift of unconditional love. A few months later, or more than that, 7-8 months later, I got a phone call from my dad. And I said, how are you doing, Dad? He said, oh, not bad. So, how are you? Not bad. I mean, he could be hanging off a roof, you know, with one arm missing. Not bad. And he said to me, could we come over? And I said, oh, that would be we, as in the collective, you. And he said, yeah, me and Mum. And I said, Dad, that would be great. That'd be great. They came over. And they spent 3 weeks for us, and we had a good time. And the last I saw my dad alive was when he walked arm in arm with my mum through the departure gate at Toronto Airport. And I came back from the funeral, and I was sitting on the bed, and I was crying. And my wife came over to me, and she hugged me and said, it's okay, it'll be okay, it'll be okay. And I said, Bern, I don't know if it will be okay. Because it's not that he lived in some terrible country facing persecution. He knew about it. I tried to tell him. He knew. He'd heard people. He kept on rejecting. He kept on saying, no, no, no. I want to see him again. I don't know if I will. And she sort of pushed me away, and she said, what? Of course you'll see him again. Did you not look at him when he came to church with us? Now, this is a really strange thing. They were there for 3 Sundays. The last Sunday, I said, Dad, we're going to church, I'll put the TV on for you. And he said, no, I'll come with you. And surprised, yeah. And I didn't look at him. I didn't think my father was going to start shouting or being rude or anything, but I thought he might be, I don't know, rolling his eyes or something. I just didn't want to get into any confrontation. You know, I didn't want to spoil anything. So I didn't look at him. And she said, Mike, as I walked back from the altar, she said, your dad, she called him Phil, his face was bright red. And it was though he was laughing and smiling and crying simultaneously. It was amazing. It was like he was going to be pulled off his chair to the front of the church. You're going to see him again. The gift of unconditional love. We can give each other hundreds of arguments, historical proof, absolutely watertight logical cases for Christ. God gives the gift of unconditional love, his son on earth to die in agony for us. He's reaching out, screaming, please know me, please come back to me. The gift of unconditional love. I get a bit tired of these ostensibly clever people telling me God doesn't exist. Don't worry. Remember that the bus ad? There's probably no God. Stop worrying. I wasn't worried anyway, actually. There is a God, and I have no worries at all. I'd be more concerned for you, Mr. Dawkins. But this idea that we have to worry if there's a God, and we're emotionally constipated if there is a God, and we're judgmental if there... No. There are people who call themselves Christians, who all of those things, but so what? Doesn't matter. God is love. made us, as I said, to love him and be loved by him. He wants us to go back to him. The pain when we choose not to and we make that choice is beyond calculation. We've all got stories. We've all got stories of the extraordinary within the ordinary, of miracles, of God's work and God's plan in our lives. I mean, there are times, and I'm sure you have, I certainly have feelings like this when you think, I wish something amazing would happen to me. You know, I wish I could, how about a little miracle today, God? I need a bit of, you know, like a bit of a theological caffeine. You're on your own. I made you. I love you. My son Christ is there for you. I want you home. But you're a big boy. You're a big boy now. Is it easy? No. It can be very challenging. Is it always satisfying? Well, there are times of emotional euphoria. Pentecostal churches seem to be full of people going through that. I'm English. I don't have that sort of thing, you know? But there's certainty. There's certainty that by relationship with Christ Jesus, we will spend eternity with our Father in heaven, understanding what life is really supposed to be about. I mentioned C.S. Lewis earlier. Everything he wrote is worth reading. There's one very small book, a monograph really, called A Grief Observed. And he writes about the death of his wife, Joy Davidman. Remarkable book. And he never loses his Christian faith. There's a movie called Shadowlands that rather indicates he did. He never lost his faith. But he was deeply unhappy, and he didn't quite see the God of love. It was God, but was it the God of love? He said, and then I let go. I was holding so tight that I let go and he was there again. Suddenly I knew God was God. And for the first time since she had died, his wife, I could see her face. It's real. Christian for a reason, or Christian for a billion reasons. But really Christian because there is no other way. There is no alternative. There is nothing else that really satisfies. I mentioned about 20 minutes ago, I'll end with this, about new wave music. When I was about 17 and 18, and you know, the Clash and the Sex Pistols, oh dear, and 999 and all the other, I just went to university. I used to watch these bands all over the place, and my favorite was the Clash. I loved the Clash. And a couple of years ago, I got an email and they said, the former drummer from The Clash has a book out. Would you like to interview him on television? And I said, what? Yeah, he can keep Stephen Harper. Yeah, I want this. And I read the book. And the drummer from The Clash, when he left The Clash, he toured with Ozzy Osbourne and Black Sabbath. And I mean, you know what he'd gone and done? He'd become a Christian. And he came in and we chatted and we had a lot in common and it was great. And I said, why? He said, well, he said, I sort of had everything really. He said, you know, they talk about sex, drugs and rock and roll. I said, well, yeah, I mean, too many hangovers, too many of my friends I saw die of drug overdoses. The sex became just irrelevant in the end. And I began to rethink about some of the things I'd heard when I was young from a Christian family. I said, I don't reject everything I went through. It was wonderful. I still have many friends in that part of my life. But you realize after a few years of having everything, the only real friend you have is a friend who doesn't come on tour with you. Well, he does in a way. And that's Christ. And that's God. And I'm a Christian. I asked him to sign an album, which he did, and I gave him a hug. And now whenever I play The Clash on CD at home, I think about those songs in a slightly different way. I What if God does as well? Christian for a reason. I'll say it again. There are a billion of them. But in the final analysis, just one. Your relationship with God. You're spending eternity with Him. It's not a bad offer, is it? All right. Let's have some questions and answers.
My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Mm. He's on the cross. And he's had this terrible torture, nails, etc., etc. What happened? Why didn't God save him then?
Well, I think this is the beautiful mystery of his nature. He was human as well as God. And this is not the northern Superman who knows no peace. He had fear. He felt pain. Otherwise, how could God give us this conduit to come for us to bring us back? He's showing his love for humanity by becoming human. And those moments of terror and anguish, I think it makes the story all the more real. And it's very interesting in terms of the Gospels because they're written for different people, of course. Some are written for the Jews, some for Gentiles. But to show the weakness of God is not a good selling point in the first and second century. Whenever people say to me, I get this argument quite a bit, well, the Gospels differ in some ways. They contradict each other, they don't. They may change, they differ in emphasis and inflection, but they don't contradict each other. But that, for me, is more of an argument for their authenticity, because when they were assembled, well, why not only choose the ones that all seem to agree? But no, they have to be divinely inspired. We have to know they were written by people who knew, or knew people who actually saw what was going on. But it shows the humanity, which is part of his nature. But it's very important to remember this, that if you're making something up, if you're doing a bit of a cosmetic job on what really happened, and you want to appeal to people, we've got the real God for you, you don't show him saying, why have you done this? You don't show him suffering. You don't show him sweating profusely. You don't show him in agony. That's not the God that people wanted at that, but particularly the Jewish people. In the Old Testament, they want a God, a Messiah, who will ride in on a white horse and defeat all of the enemy. That's what they want. You're giving us this? Are you kidding me? No! So I find it very interesting on many levels. Great, good question. Thank you.
I have a question about language, and I'm curious about your thoughts on the language that Christians use in conversation with non-Christians. How do you bridge the language gap or the Christian, non-Christian barrier?
That's good, yeah.
Something like that.
Well, I think you have to share the journey that's on your heart and be really beautiful and awesome about it. That was a joke. I really do not like Christianese. And Anglicans generally, thank goodness, are not purveyors. They don't use the vocabulary of Christianese. But certainly in the, and I understand, I mean, there's several parts to this question, but we sometimes, Christians sometimes use a language that is very, it's almost incestuous, really, and it makes them feel comfortable. I remember my wife, who's very clever, has far more degrees and things than I do. This is years ago, and it was, I'm not sure which baby it was, but it has to be at least 17, because she was changing one of the kids in diapers. And we were at a large evangelical church. So here she is with her BAs and MAs and PhDs and things. And these two women came up to her, and they were talking. And they went up to her, and they said, because my wife's Roman Catholic, and they said, we'd like to ask you a question. My wife said, yep, yeah. Diaper, poo, stuff. And they said, are you saved? And to a Catholic, you might as well be speaking Flemish at this point. That concept doesn't really exist. And she said, well, I'm working out my salvation with fear and trembling, And they walked off, and we heard one of them say, she's not saved. So we have to hold the door as open as widely as possible, and often we close it so it's hardly open at all. It's very difficult to speak as a Christian to people who are not Christian, I find. The last thing you want to be is boring, annoying. My first day at university in 1977, I'd never been away from home overnight. In those days, you just didn't travel that much. And no, that's not true. I'd been to Europe on holiday with my family, but I'd never been on my own. And I'd never really been much north of London, apart from to watch football matches, soccer matches. Strange, really. But I was at university, and I was sharing a lovely room, huge room, with a guy who was from Blackburn in Lancashire. It's rather ironic, because my son then played at Blackburn Rovers, but that's another story. But anyway, he had this broad Lancashire accent. And he came in, and we shook hands, and he said, "You're right." He said, "Are you a Christian?" I thought he was German. I said, "What? What? Yeah, are you a Christian?" And I said, "No." And that really threw me away from Christianity. It shouldn't have, but it was so annoying. I mean, the first thing he said to me was, "Are you a Christian?" Well, no. That's not the way to start a conversation. You know, you speak to people. They know where you come from. You try to form a relationship. I'm not particularly good at this, but, you know, we use the term witness. It should be implicit. It should be inherent in everything we do. The Archbishop of Canterbury, I can say this because your Archbishop said it. Rowan Williams, one of the most brilliant theologians of past half a century, I would argue, brilliant man. Probably shouldn't have been Archbishop of Canterbury. He's too brilliant for that, if I'm getting into trouble here. But I mean, there were too many challenges, I think. But as a theologian and an intellect, he's superb. But he said this, so forgive me if it sounds a little bit. But he said, often you want what, if you see someone and they're a Christian, they're wonderful, you want what they have. And he referred to a very famous scene in When Harry Met Sally, in the restaurant. Do you know what I'm talking about? Well, I'm not going to do it here, but when the woman said, "I'll have what she's having." Well, and if you don't know what I mean, watch it when you get home. It's a great movie. But if someone seems to be really together and impressive, and not brilliant or wonderfully good-looking, but there's something in their life, often I want that. So if we seem to be unhappy and mean-spirited, and there are quite a few, I'm sorry, Christians I've met who are like that, no one's going to say, "Oh, I want that. I want to be really judgmental too. That's brilliant. I really like that. You know, I want to wake up every morning and decide, who do I hate today? I mean, that's really good. I want that." So I think we can inspire in such a way. We always have to have a ready defense and answer, but it doesn't mean we're all prepared to give the intellectual arguments. Some of us don't have that gift. If I could have anything, I would have played soccer for England. Mind you, anyone can do that these days. But, you know, I don't have that gift. We have different gifts, but we all do have. And they can be the most, what seems to be, the most ordinary, basic, common gift. But one of the people I admire most in the world is my oldest friend, Steve. He was best man at my wedding. 2 children, married, not famous in any way. He's a planner. He's in private practice now. People want to live in 17th century cottages. He gets all the permission, the planning, all this sort of thing. He's content. I have never quite found that contentment. I wish I had what he had. If we can show non-Christians that, I think we'd go a long way to getting people to want to know more. Thank you.
Thank you very much, by the way. It's very interesting and different than what I had expected or anticipated.
Yeah, you thought I'd be horrible.
No, not at all. But I thought it would be a much more serious, and that's the wrong term, not with the levity. But you talked about crimes and the Christian church being accused of crimes, and it isn't that it's people. And I agree that it is people behind it. But I think we also have to be able to talk about things like the Inquisition, you were speaking, and I guess more importantly in my mind these days, how do we talk about things like the Crusades, which although that was people and politics, I'm assuming, was still done in the name of the church. And I think we need to be able to talk about that with the current situation in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, actually, I've 2 of the books out there. Well, 2 of them talk about the Inquisition and the Crusades, and 1 of them talks about the Crusades specifically. I could give you historical explanations of what really happened, but I think we have to begin by saying they were wrong. And Jesus would not have wanted armies to travel to the Middle East and fight wars. There is nothing in the life and teaching of Jesus to support this proposition. The Inquisition, there is nothing in the writing of Jesus that in any way would have supported the church using state mechanism to interrogate, arrest, and torture people who didn't quite agree with the prevailing theology of the time. They were wrong. Now, that they are not as bad as people claim is relevant. We need to have knowledge. The Inquisition, the average European saw the Inquisition once every 30 years. The Department of Homeland Security has far more power than the Inquisition ever had. If you went before the Inquisition, you were guaranteed a lawyer. There were criminals who would blaspheme because they'd rather go before the Inquisition than an ordinary criminal court. 80-odd% of all people taken to the Inquisition were set free. They include Ignatius Loyola, founder of the Jesuits. There were many Inquisitions. The one we tend to know about was the Spanish Inquisition. Spain was a country that had just freed itself from Islamic rule, at least in a large part of it. Islam is an expansionist religion. It had conquered much of Spain. There was still a very large Muslim and Jewish minority, and how times change. At that point, Jews and Muslims tended to be allied. And what was done, I mean, it put religious minorities in a terrible position, because particularly after the expulsion of the Jewish people in 1492, they had lived there for hundreds and hundreds of years. And many had converted, by the way. The family of Torquemada, the infamous inquisitor, the Jewish family. His grandparents were Jewish. But when the expulsion happened, people who had lived there for hundreds of years, Spanish Jews, were told, you can only stay if you convert. So quite a few, particularly religious, said, all right, well, we'll convert. But there wasn't a real conversion. They were called Marranos. And so they converted, but nominally. And then the Inquisition started to investigate them and found out they weren't genuine conversions, and they got into terrible trouble. So it was horrible. And it was horrible on so many levels. It wasn't as bad as we think, to be honest. The Inquisition has been, the story has been told by North American and British Protestant historians to really attack the Catholic Church. The Protestant Church has little to boast about. Elizabeth was disemboweling people. So, I mean, Christianity is not its finest moments, but it was wrong. It was absolute. The state, whenever church and state come together, it doesn't go well. The church is at its most Christian, it seems to me, when it's in a minority, trying to define what it believes. And the Catholic Church is going through this, well, you see, Quebec, Ireland, Spain, Italy, where the church had complete power, you have the majority of people rejecting it when they can have their own say. The Crusades is more of an issue because it's used now by those people who are opposing Western policy. I mean, I thought the Iraq War was a terrible decision. I think Afghanistan was justified. I don't see how we could get out of it. America was attacked. They are an ally. They wouldn't hand over the Taliban. I think there had to be some intervention in Afghanistan. I think Iraq was a dreadful decision. And I think the main victims of the war in Iraq are Iraqi Christians, two-thirds of whom have either been killed or had to leave. Saddam Hussein was a monster, but what has replaced him is even worse. And could we not have replaced him rather than just destroyed the whole regime and everything about it? But anyway. But the Crusades, what they were, Egypt was a majority Christian country with a Jewish and pagan minority. This was the heartland and homeland of Christianity. Islam came from Arabia. Forcible conversions, or people were so heavily taxed, they had to convert because they couldn't keep paying the head tax that Islam imposed. And then there were persecutions of Christians. Holy places were destroyed. Eventually, Latin Christianity, listening to the cries of Orthodox Christians, went in and war took place. It was never an attempt to convert people to Christianity. It was very brief, but generally that was never an issue. It was never proselytizing. It was making sure the holy places were safe, making sure pilgrims were safe, but often Eastern Christians were slaughtered as well. I mean, the Crusaders killed Jews in Germany, although I have to say the Pope and St. Bernard personally intervened to try and stop that. But Orthodox Christians who were Arabs were also killed by the Crusaders. Often it was an ethnic persecution that took place. But it was war. And the Crusaders could be horrible in the way they behaved and valiant. Saladin and his people could be the same. You know, Saladin was a Kurd, you know. He wasn't an Arab, he was a Kurd. Look how they're treated now. The Crusaders were so horrible and the Saracens were so wonderful. I've never met a Shia Muslim in Egypt. I don't know if there are any, I've never met one. Saladin got rid of them all. Ethnic cleansing, he wiped out the Shia population of Egypt. These were brutal people. So what do the Crusades tell us? The Crusades tell us that the 11th and 12th century, two great empires, the Latin Catholic Empire and the emerging Ottoman Empire, clashed. It doesn't say very much about what's happening today, and it doesn't say anything about Islam, I believe. But again, the first thing, as a Christian, they were wrong. We tend to do that. We tend to say they were wrong. I have to say, I don't hear Muslim leaders apologizing for what they have done over the years. Now, they conquered by the sword much of the Christian world. I haven't heard any apologies. So whilst I'm more than willing to say we were wrong, I'm not going to throw out the intellect with the Christian bathwater. I'm not going to pretend it's all on one side. We have to be honest about all this as well.
Quality of life.
Yeah.
What does it include for you or what it doesn't?
Right.
Question one. Question two. I have at workplace variety of people with different backgrounds. And sometimes I have a subtle Christian conversation without saying Christianity. Well, you answer the question. And once I have a 15 minutes from atheist speak about his belief. And he said in compressing his 15 minute spiel, said, I can make a decisions by myself. Looks like everybody else in every religion cannot do it, they need the help. I can do without it. That's why I don't need a God and I don't want to know it.
Right.
What would you say?
Okay. Good question. What do we mean by quality of life? It can be a very dangerous phrase. I think life is the issue, not quality of life. Because once we say quality of life, it tends to be those who believe they have a great deal of it, judging those they believe don't have very much of it. And whatever your ability or lack of, I mentioned my niece earlier, goodness, we don't want to be too precious about this, but those who are often said to have limited quality of life through disability or handicap can be some of the most wonderful, forgiving, loving people we've ever met. And it's a dangerous phrase to use because it tends to be a precursor to arguing that some people shouldn't be allowed to be around. They shouldn't be born, they should leave early. And while the whole pro-life argument has to be considered in context, and there's too much, there's a simplistic approach. You know, it involves education and empowerment and gender equality and so many things. It's not just about banning things. But and euthanasia, similar. We have to have a very holistic approach to this. But quality of life always worries me. Because what's the next thing we say? Do we judge a quality of life and then say, isn't that nice? Or do we say, quality of life, how should we deal with that? So I believe life itself is the issue. That's God-given. That we don't live up to the rather rancid expectations of the first few years of the 21st century, quality of life. I mean, I'm always reluctant to talk about the Third Reich because, I mean, it always goes wrong, but it is worth remembering the first people to die were so-called Aryan people who were mentally handicapped. The quality of life was insufficient. To the atheist who says, I don't need a God to make decisions. Well, of course you don't. No one ever said you did. You know, we don't argue that. It's not about making decisions. As I said earlier, you can be extremely happy as an atheist. Most of the people I know, I think, are sort of lukewarm atheists. They never really thought about it very much, but they don't really have a particular belief in God. They can make decisions. They tend to get it wrong. You know, I mentioned Bertrand Russell because Russell, who was a brilliant man, whose papers, by the way, are in Hamilton, McMaster University, the world center for Bertrand Russell studies. I mean, he came to the conclusion he couldn't call himself an atheist. He said, look, if I am a complete materialist, if I proclaim we can only know something if we have seen it, then I can't call myself an atheist, because the converse of this is I can only say it doesn't exist if I've seen everything. Well, I can never see everything, so I can't say I'm an atheist. I can't say there's no God. I highly doubt it, but I cannot say there is no God. But people who say they're atheists today tend not to be. They're just angry with what they think is the church. There are some atheists who are well-read, but most of the people I meet who call themselves atheists are rather upset with mum and dad, and they're at university, and they bought but didn't quite read a book by Richard Dawkins. And, you know, anyone who... I heard a British comedian, a very funny man actually, but he said he was a Christian till he read The God Delusion. Well, baby, you must have been a pretty bad Christian, because I've read books that have challenged my faith, but The God Delusion? Are you serious? I mean, it's such a deeply flawed book. Chris Hitchens, one of the funniest, wittiest men I ever met, wrote brilliantly, apart from when he wrote about faith and theology. It's deeply flawed. There are better people in the atheist world than that, and they can be a bit of a problem. But yes, you can make decisions, and you will make moral decisions and noble decisions. We could, though, as an atheist, but we could ask the question, why? Why would you do that? Why? We could ask about what is the motivation. And even if you don't believe it's God, do you think there is something within you that is God-given? We often hear, I mean, we've all heard, you know, more wars fought in the name of Christianity or religion than anything else. We know that, isn't it? It's a suburban cliche. It's not true. It's simply not true. I covered Northern Ireland for a while in the early 80s when I was a journalist, and I can assure you it had nothing to do with religion. I mean, the IRA had become Marxist years before. Someone said to me recently, the IRA are Catholic. And I said, well, I sat down for 2 hours to interview Gerry Adams, head of Sinn Féin, and I can assure you, head of the IRA as well. And he said to me, Michael, we are not Roman Catholic. We haven't been in 35 years. We're not Roman Catholic. But apparently this person knew more than the head of Sinn Féin and the IRA, because they wanted to think it. And the UVF and the UDA, the Protestant, so-called Protestant paramilitaries, I knew these guys. I was based for a while in Ballymoney, County Antrim. I used to go to the same pub. They were terrifying. They weren't religious. It was a tribe. It was two tribes went to war. People have fought wars over religion. But when you say, yes, but the great slaughters were in the great century of atheism, the 20th century, they say, no. Nazis and communists and Pol Pot and Mao had nothing. It wasn't because they were atheists. Hold on a minute. They may not have said, we're going to kill you because we're an atheist. But where did their moral compass go? Why suddenly did they have no concern at all about their actions? Of course there was an atheistic motivation behind that. And it's a common thread, whether it's National Socialism or Soviet Communism or whether it's the Khmer Rouge or whether it's Maoist Communism. God is dead. And on a purely practical note, good Lord, the first places they went were religious. The Soviets, what is very interesting about the Soviets is as soon as they went to an area, churches and synagogues, it wasn't a particularly anti-Semitic policy. You just have to stop being religious. You have to go. Religion has to die. And it won't do for atheists to say it's always about religion. Of course there have been religious wars, but religion was all that mattered, remember. People fought wars about religion, but Richard III has just been buried, right, in England? The Wars of the Roses. Religion? They were all Catholic. No, it was about two powerhouses fighting each other. It was not about religion. People think if wars were fought in the 17th century, 16th, 15th, they were about religion. That's just a misunderstanding of history. So sometimes, you know, when you're arguing with an atheist, hit them with a book. That's often the best. No, that was a joke. I don't mean that.
Thank you. Wow, that's quite the night. Well, bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time with us this night. It has been a real pleasure. Thank you so much.